Raamla Mohamed, welcome to the show. How are you?
Good. How are you, Kayla?
I'm good. To everybody watching, I'm Kayla Guest. I'm with Final Draft. I am the director of the Big Break Screenwriting Contest, and I am the content producer for Final Draft. So if you want to read our articles and craft and interviews with the pros, that's at blog.finaldraft.com. And today we have Raamla Mohamed from Little Fires Everywhere. She is the co-EP and writer. And we're so grateful to everyone who submitted questions because, I mean, at least myself, I was obsessed with the show. I kept thinking it was releasing on Tuesdays, and then my kid would be like, "No, mom, it's Wednesday."
It was Tuesday if Tuesday at 9 p.m. So it was like Wednesday at midnight.
I'm not up past 9. So. Well, thanks again for joining us. We're gonna go through the questions and answer everything everyone wants to know about Little Fires Everywhere. Are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
All right, cool. So the first question we have is from Liz. She's on Twitter at Liz Criolla. And if I said that wrong, I'm sorry, Liz. I'm very sensitive to mispronunciations. Liz wants to know, what do you hope audiences, especially women, can take away from this show?
Well, you know, it was a very interesting experience in the writer's room. There were 7 female writers and 1 male writer. And so I think what was great is that we were able to have all these conversations about different women's experience, whether you're a mother or you're not a mother. I think for women, you know, a lot of times we judge ourselves, and because we judge ourselves, we judge each other in a way that can be destructive and not productive and not helpful to understanding each other and also, supporting each other. So as a woman, you know, just being on the show, but also, you know, writing the show, it was interesting to see how, just as either a mother or a daughter, these little ways, these microaggressions that happen between women that really can be detrimental to all of us. So I hope that women watching the show can see something within themselves, that ugly part that, you know, Mia Warren talks about in the show, that, you know, that people don't often want to look at, and can look at that part of themselves and see, you know, how they can change.
Yes, yes. And I would say Elena was loaded with those microaggressions.
Yes, for sure.
Great job of capturing that. So our next question is Isabella Masato. She's also on Twitter. She asked us a few questions. So we're just going to go through all of her questions. They will be scrolled across the bottom here so that you guys can actually read along. The first question, and she's on Twitter at Bella Happy Feet. Her first question is, what do you think both mothers could have learned from each other? Are there little fires in each other's lives that they could have put out before it consumed them? So I guess we'll start at the first question is, what do you think the mothers could have learned from each other? What could Elena have learned from Mia?
Well, I think what's great is that, you know, in episode 2, you see kind of a glimpse of what could have happened, you know, if these women in some ways hadn't gotten in each other's business or way, or, you know, when after the book club, you know, Mia kind of helps Elena out, who hasn't read the book, The Vagina Monologues. And then they have a, you know, glass of wine, and they have this wonderful conversation that Nancy Wan wrote, that episode, and talking about what motherhood is like and what, you know, seeds and all. And you see that there's a bond between these women that could have been, you know, but of course Elena, you know, felt the need to involve herself with Pearl's essay, and Mia had kept these secrets from Pearl all these years. So she feels, you know, kind of this attachment to her, and also this possession of Pearl that, you know, really upsets her and makes her not want to, you know, connect with Elena. So I think that there is a lot that the women could have learned from each other as far as, you know, the difficulty of being a mom, especially, you know, Elena says, like, do you think your kid, you know, likes you? You know, these fears and learning from each other how to parent. And maybe Mia could have helped Elena see Izzy for who she really is and accept her, you know, in a way. But all these things get in the way, the secrets, the assumptions, the judgments, And I think they got in the way for both of the characters, actually.
Yeah, and what I found interesting is that they both were unknowingly helping each other out because of the child that was, you know, respectively going to the other for help because they were more aligned with their own beliefs.
Right, exactly.
Going to Alina and what have you. So I love the way you guys played that. So Isabella's next question is, the women are from different backgrounds, but what would you say is the thing that makes them similar?
I think what makes them similar is that they are actually both selfish in different ways. I think Alina is selfish in the way that she wants everything to be perfect, the way that she thinks that, you know, whatever her thoughts or feelings or the way she lives her life is the way that everyone should live their life. I also think that she, you know, only thinks about how things affect her. And if she does something or she, you know, that is bad or it's her, you know, that she feels isn't her fault, then she's never going to take blame. In fact, the only time she takes blame is not until the very end of episode 8, where she takes, you know, responsibility for the fire. So I think that, you know, she's definitely a selfish character. And I also think Mia is selfish. She wants to continue her art, but she also wanted Pearl. So she, you know, kind of created this life where they go around and move around all the time, which, you know, which Pearl didn't want at all, really, as we learn in the series, and didn't really ask her opinion about, you know, what this lifestyle would be. In addition to the fact that, you know, Mia had access to all this money that she chose not to use until, you know, the BB trial, that she didn't use to help Pearl and her have a better situation. So yeah, I think that's the ways that both the characters are selfish. And I think, you know, just like Alina kind of has a selfless moment in the end, I think for Mia, her selfless moment is asking Pearl, you know, when they leave, like, where do you want to go? What, you know, you're now a, you know, a person in this relationship, who has opinions that I respect and is important to me. So I'm going to tell you the truth about, you know, where you came from and let you decide where you want to go. So.
Yeah. Selfishness. I would say that's a really good point. Even when Mia decided to disappear with her pregnancy, and that right. was like her first act of selfishness, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah.
So they both make, this is also from Isabella, they both make poor decisions. So how do you still write them as redeemable characters?
You know, it's interesting, and when you're developing a show or you're, you know, talking about a show, a lot of times, you know, execs and studios, you know, throw around the word likable, you know, like a character has to be likable. But I think that audiences in some ways are kind of okay with characters being unlikable, you know, on shows. And I think it makes the shows more interesting. It makes the characters more interesting. I think it appeals to the actors more to play these roles. But like I said before, I think that, if you want to talk about what makes them redeemable, I think what makes them redeemable is that they're human and they're flawed. And I think that we did a good job of kind of following the reasons behind their mistakes. You know, in the flashback, you see, you know, what happened when, before Alina got pregnant, you know, with Izzy, what happened, why Mia kept Pearl. And so I think that you're able to at least understand and see their decisions through yeah. their eyes. And whether you agree with them or not, I think that at least you're able to empathize and understand, okay, well, I guess I could understand why she kept Pearl. Not that I agree with it, but I can at least understand yeah. that emotionally why she did that. I can understand, you know, why Alina felt this way about Izzy, because she really didn't want this pregnancy but felt like she had no choice. So again, it doesn't excuse the behavior, but I do think that empathy plays a huge role in making characters be redeemable. And also, you know, like I said, in the end, each of them do something selfless, whether it's a small act or a big one, that I do think helps us realize that, okay, I watched the show and at least understood that these people have grown in some way.
Yeah, I would agree. You guys did a great job of that for sure. And I have to say, when I, the scene where you see Mia make the decision, you know, mentally to drive off with Pearl in her, while she was pregnant. And I'm a mom, I have a teenager, and I think, like, I don't know what I would have done, because, you know, we just, they're all such personal, intimate situations, so those selfish fires everywhere. Don't turn to the title.
Yeah, exactly.
So our last question from Isabella, who, by the way, these are all great questions, so thank you, Isabella, for taking the time to submit them for us. She wants to know, it's clear that they love their families, Elena and Mia, but are their actions driven by love or fear?
Well, I think that when you love someone, a lot of fear comes into play. Mm-hmm. You know, I know my mom, you know, when I was younger, I got really sick, and when I was like 3 and I almost died, and I can't imagine, you know, the fear to have, you know, to have that fear, to love something so much, to fear that something's going to happen to them. Mm-hmm. So just on the, I think on a basic level, I think that, you know, I'm not a mother, but, you know, I'm a daughter, and I can understand that when that love is there, the fear of losing that love, can be, you know, very huge, particularly looking at Elena and Mia, looking at Elena's life and seeing, you know, how much she's put into her family, how much she's sacrificed for her family. So that she does that out of love, but anything that's going to kind of threaten the family dynamic, whether it's, you know, Bill or, you know, Pearl coming between Moody and Tripp or Mia or whatever it is, I think the fear kicks in and she's going to do whatever she can to protect it. And in the same way Mia does with Pearl, where she feels like, you know, the Richardsons are a threat in some way to her and Pearl's relationship, or that, you know, if Bibi doesn't get the baby, then that means maybe she doesn't deserve Pearl. So I think that those actions, again, they're based in love, but I think what makes people do things that, you know, can be questionable are driven by fear, but I think they're so interconnected.
So our next question is from Yolanda Lewis. She is on Twitter, The Lewis Effect, super cute. She wants to know, she says, you've collaborated with Kerry Washington on different projects, including the upcoming series, Reasonable Doubt. What's the working relationship like?
I absolutely adore Kerry. Like I don't think besides my own family could love a person anymore. She's so supportive and just such a great actress and talent. You know, we worked together on Scandal for many years.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was always fun and great to be on set with her and kind of talk through the different scenes. But she was very, you know, kind and talked to me about Little Fires and the new project and introduced me to Liz Tiglar, who's amazing. And so it was great to kind of, you know, be on this journey with her again, you know, working together. And at least I knew, I was like, okay, well, no matter what happens, you know, I know that, you know, Kerry is a consummate professional and also brings such a respect and dignity, you know, into the crew and working with all the producers. And it was great to, you know, meet Reese Witherspoon and work with her as well and her company. So it really was a wonderful experience. And then, you know, yeah, I'm developing another project with Carrie's company. So I told her that she can't get rid of me.
You guys are a package deal. At
I was like, maybe we'll be like Scorsese and DiCaprio or something.
Yeah. I was thinking that when I was reading her question, I was reading Yolanda's question. I was like, I remember when I fell in love with the show Scandal, what does it feel like to write for Olivia Pope, you know?
No, it was, you know, it was fun. And then, you know, on Scandal, I was a young writer, you know, when I started out. So, you know, I learned a lot, you know, in that writer's room from Shonda Rhimes and, you know, Mark Wilding and Mark Fish and, you know, the kind of heads of the shows. But also the actors were just so incredible on that show, not just Kerry, but, you know, Tony Goldwyn, Bellamy Young, you know, Jeff Perry. I mean, so many guest stars, you know, came on. So you know, I think it was very helpful to be able to learn how to write on a show where the actors were so smart and invested, because it really, you know, when we went to set, I really had to prepare myself and understand, like, you know, why I was writing certain scenes, or, you know, what it was about, and, yeah, you know, really understand the story. So it was a great training that, you know, once I got to Little Fires, definitely, you know, helped me as well.
I love it. Well, I hope to see you guys do a lot more together.
Yes, me too.
This is our campaign. our next question is from Malisha B. And Malisha, I hope I'm saying your name correctly, and I'm sorry if I didn't. She's on Twitter as Tweely Tweeta. And her question is, what episode of Little Fires Everywhere is your favorite, and why? Is it the one you wrote?
It is not the one I wrote, but I mean, I like my episode.
You vote for yourself here.
It's my episode. Yeah. You know, it's interesting. I was, the writers and I are on a text chain, group text chain that we like love each other. Like, mm-hmm. So we still keep in contact and send funny, things either about the show or just about life, particularly during this time. Oh, and, you know, as we were watching the show, I was always amazed that every episode was better than the last episode. You know, I mean, Liz Tiglar's pilot is so great and so well constructed and really sets up the tension of what the show is going to be. But yeah, every episode after that really just builds and builds. And so, I mean, it's hard to say. I think if I had to, I think I'd give it a tie. I think episode 8 is definitely my favorite, just because the way everything comes together. And it was written by Amy Talkington, who was on set with us. I just think the directing by Lynn Shelton is great. The kids are, you know, phenomenal in that episode. Reese and Carrie give amazing performances. There's some really powerful scenes, and just, you know, the way it wraps up with Shannon Houston wrote a beautiful poem at the end.
Yeah.
It's just really, it really ties together, and it's very emotional. And then my other favorite episode is episode 6, which is written by Shannon Houston and directed by Nzinga Stewart. Just such a beautiful episode, flashing back to, you know, Elena and Mia's backstories.
Yeah.
And Elena's backstory wasn't much in the book. We had to kind of make that up, even though Mia's was a kind of fully constructed backstory in the book, but which we, you know, obviously expanded upon. But I mean, I just thought, you know, that episode really just had this kind of, like flow and energy and really, you know, to what I was saying about empathy, like, I think you really do get a peek into why these women are the way they are. And performances from Tiffany Boone and Anna Sophia Robb are so incredible. They both captured, you know, Reese and Carrie's nuances and performance. I'd say that episodes, you know, episodes 106 and episode 108 are kind of tied to be my favorite.
Yeah, I would say 106 stood out for me too, because like you said, that is where we learned more about Mia's backstory. Because myself as a mom, I had a hard time like trying to figure out a lot of the reasons that Mia was the way she was. And you guys did a very good job in episode 6 of checking off all those boxes for me. Like, okay, this is why she's this way. This is why she, you know, made these decisions. But it also was just a different, almost a little bit of a different tone, you know, just,
yeah,
which was good. You know, I think midway through the season that way to just kind of make any show feel fresh. I love when shows mix up tones like that. So I think you guys did a great job of that for sure.
Yeah. And also, you know, we had really great directors, Michael Weaver, Lynn Shelton, and Nzinga Stewart, but episode 6, I think Nzinga really captured that, the magic of the time period that these women went through, and also the pain in such a beautiful way.
Our next question is to describe your experience on the show. And there's a second question, what's your favorite storyline? But let's talk about your experience on the show, your experience in the writer's room. Can you talk about the differences of being in a room where you're adapting existing IP versus creating an entire season. What was the experience for you on Little Fires Everywhere?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. So this is the second show I've been on where there was a book as a kind of source material. Mm-hmm. The first show was still Star-Crossed, and then now Little Fires. You know, it's very interesting, but also fun and a little easier, to be honest. when you have source material, especially a book like Celeste's book that is just so rich and phenomenal, and it was, you know, we read it a bunch of times, and even when I first read it, I was like, okay, this is so exciting. So I think each of us, there were 8 of us in the room, I think each of us, what was great is that we each specifically had different experiences that connected us to the writer's room. I think Liz Tiglar did a great job of crafting a room where, you know, you had like me, I kind of identified with the Mia Pearl storyline because I'm the, you know, only child of a single parent. And, you know, being a Black woman, I'm actually, you know, around Pearl's age. I was in high school in the 90s during that time. And then we had, you know, Liz was adopted. Another writer was adopted. A few people from Ohio. So they, you know, familiar with Shaker. Amy Talkington, she's an artist. So she was instrumental in, you know, talking about the artwork. I think there was a lot of different personal experiences that everyone could bring to the story. And it was also a very safe and comfortable environment. So people felt, you know, comfortable sharing, you know, these experiences and personal stories in a way that I think made the show, you know, kind of come alive and really feel real and specific.
And what was your favorite storyline?
My favorite storyline was actually the whole like Brian Lexi storyline about, you know, starting off kind of at the end of episode 2 where she takes the essay and then all the way till the breakup in episode 7. Because I think, you know, for me, I think it really shows this idea of, you know, white privilege and also you know, I think the nuances of that relationship was very interesting to see, you know, this interracial relationship. And again, you know, given that the story and the show was about me and Pearl coming into this town and how they, you know, no pun intended, shake things up. And I think that storyline showed that, you know, there were definitely some cracks in that relationship and how kind of Pearl in the essay exposed that whole storyline.
I thought too, you guys did a really good job of showing, not telling, the code switching that happens. When Pearl and Ryan were alone, the conversation was different than what it was, you know, and then the coaching at the dinner table, you know, she's
right.
Bringing this up, the one time she marched with Dr. King.
Right, yeah, exactly.
And you know, I feel like this is, I could be wrong, but I feel like it's one of the first shows that I've seen that happen where they didn't have to say the words code switching. The next question is from Saeed Crumpler. He is on Twitter at balance510. He wants to know if you have any advice for a new writer that are getting ready to get into their first writer's room. So they've got their representation, they're in the middle of staffing season, they might get into a room. Advice for them?
I think, you know, when you're a staff writer, I think, you know, especially because this was my experience, is that I was an assistant for quite some time. So when I became a writer, it was like, okay, like, I gotta like talk and make sure and like be amazing. And that's just not going to happen. And I mean, it's unless you're, you know, some magic superstar. But I think really the expectation is that you're not going to be annoying and that that you should be helpful. So I think that for me, you know, the room was very difficult in the first gosh, like 2 years really, of being in the writer's room. It moved really fast. I mean, Scandal was a fast show. There are a lot of characters. You know, Shonda would come in. She's a genius. So she'd come in and just say a bunch of things and I would be confused. I know it was great, but I it was so everyone understood and I felt like I couldn't understand. So I think that, I think for me, I really would go home at night and reread the writer's assistant's notes and refresh myself. And then I'd come in the next day and kind of think about where were the points, you know, in the day where there was a struggle or we didn't figure something out. And I try to come in fresh and pitch something because my skill to, like, you know, pitch at whim, you know, hadn't really settled in yet. I hadn't developed that yet. I was still learning. So I had to go home every night and really think about the stories and, you know, try to come up with things that could work. And even if they didn't work, I think that my superiors appreciated the hard work and tenacity I was putting in. And in addition, I would, you know, write, you know, in Scandal, we had a lot of like news, you know, coverage. And so sometimes they'd have to play in the background of scenes and, you know, no one could hear it, but it had to be written and recorded. So a lot of times I'd write that stuff, you know, that no one really wanted to write, yeah. You know, but needed to be written. So yeah, I think just trying to be helpful, willingness to learn, you know, being 110% in that often doesn't mean talking a lot. It means listening. Mm-hmm. It means, you know, I instead of going to the showrunner, sometimes I went to like a mid-level writer every, you know, 6 months or something and might be like, hey, like, you know, how do you think I'm doing? I'm really trying to like learn, you know, or hey, I wrote these scenes. Do you mind just reading them right quick before I turn them in to like the boss? Tell me what you think. So yeah, so utilizing your allies and just working hard.
What does that look like? So for the new writers who maybe don't understand the difference between pitching to a studio or pitching to a manager versus pitching in a room. When you're pitching concepts in a room, what does that actually look like?
You know, it depends. So we, you know, in the early parts of when you're in pre-production, sometimes you're just pitching episode ideas or, mm-hmm. you know, like on Little Fires or pitching cold opens. So it really depends. You know, when we get into the episode kind of specifics, you're pitching, you can pitch dialogue, you can pitch a scene. So it requires, you know, different skills and people have different skills. Some people are good at coming in and saying, I think, you know, Elena should start the fire. You know, some people are really good at having big ideas. And then other people are just good at kind of making really interesting scenes. And some people are both, you know. But I think that's, you know, what you kind of learn as you're in the writer's room for any given amount of time, what your skill set is and how to improve maybe what you're not, you know, so great at. Yeah. So yeah, but pitching, I mean, when you're pitching to a studio or a manager, it's different because, you know, you really have to present the whole story in such a clear way and also in a kind of entertaining way. And not that you don't have to do that in the writer's room, but, you know, when you're working with a group of people for a while, it doesn't have to be as structured and laid out. But I do think that, you know, overall, when you're in a writer's room, you know, if you're known to be a person who has good ideas, people are more likely to listen to you. But again, if you talk too much and you ramble on, then people are kind of like, okay, get to yeah. So that's why it's, you know, it's important to really make sure that, you know, when you talk, it, you know, you're really saying something.
Our last question comes from Tope Nguyen, who's a friend here at Final Draft. She runs the Bitch Pack over on Twitter, which is kind of the whistleblowing, I guess, collective for the space of inclusion and representation. She also runs the Bitch List, so she features you know, underrepresented writers, their scripts, so, you know, to help them get signed and get discovered. But her question is, how did you know people are ready to see white privilege, white feminism critiqued on screen? This is a major milestone. And I agree. And Tope gave me, like I was telling you earlier, she gave me my public learn session of what white feminism is. So if you don't mind, just a quick explanation of what white feminism is, or I can, whatever you're comfortable with.
Well, it's interesting. It's interesting because, well, white feminism essentially is this idea that, that instead of, you know, as a feminist, this idea is that, okay, you're for the rights and inequality for all women. But this idea of white feminism is that really, you're really interested in the idea of white women's rights versus everyone's rights. And you know, you see this a lot where they talk about, you know, in the 1920s that all women were given the, you know, the right to vote. Well, all women were not given the right to vote. White women were given the right to vote. And black women and black people didn't get it until, you know, the 1960s. So I think that's kind of the idea that that feminism is really white feminism. So I think, I mean, as far as people, you know, knowing if people were going to be ready, I don't know if we all thought that everyone would be ready. I think we hoped that this was something that we could talk about. I know that, you know, Liz Tigelar, the showrunner and creator of the show, mm-hmm. When we first came in the writer's room, gave us the book, A White Fragility, and which is a great book that I think everyone should read. Just talking about, which, you know, the subject is like, why are white people so uncomfortable talking about racism? Because this idea that I think is, you know, particularly if you're a liberal white person, is that, you know, if you have black friends or you don't try to keep black people out of institutions or you're not lynching people, you know, then you're not a racist. Because the word racist has such huge, you know, implications, and people fear and are
responsibility, I think.
Yeah. And also are immediately defensive about hearing that word. And so, in Robin DiAngelo's book, I think that's her name. In her book, she goes through and talks about kind of how we cannot solve racism essentially if we're even uncomfortable just talking about it or saying the word. So, you know, we definitely use that book as, you know, kind of talking about those topics. But I think also, you know, we had a pretty diverse room. So I think that we were able to bring our own experiences into the story, and also be specific about those microaggressions that happen. Yeah. You're, you know, a woman of color, a person of color, and just, you know, white liberalism and all those topics that I really don't think that, given the, you know, what the show was about, this scandal that happens with Bibi and Linda and the baby and talking about interracial adoption and all these things. I think those conversations, it almost would have been irresponsible not to have those conversations.
Yeah. It would have been authentic, right? Like Elena, to me, I feel like you guys captured the picture of white feminism and those microaggressions in her character perfectly, because I, as a white woman, remember those conversations and those comments coming out of other white women's mouths. And I was just, if anyone doesn't understand white feminism, go watch Elena.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And the thing I think that was important is, you know, you had Mia's character, I mean, you have Mia Warren going in and working in this white woman's house. And it's just, we have to talk about what this means, you know, you know, what their dynamic is, why Elena, you know, calls the cops on Mia and Pearl. And then why does she then, you know, give them the apartment? All of this is a lot of liberal guilt and a lot of,
I was gonna say white guilt.
Yeah, you know, and feeling, and then feeling, why does she feel that Mia should be grateful and, you know, to her and indebted to her just because you know, she's her landlord. You know, what are all these implications, both racially, socially, and also class? You know, class is a big thing that plays out in the show and the book too. So mm-hmm. I think if you're creating content and you're questioning, like, are people going to be ready for this? Is this okay? You know, is this something that is going to be okay? Then I don't think you should be doing it. I think you can look at a lot of shows, you know, whether it's the, you know, Cosby Show or Will and Grace or, you know, I don't know. And I mean, anything, you know, any of these shows that are Fresh Prince of Bel Air, and people can go, well, I don't know if people are going to be ready to see a rich black family on TV. Yeah. Or are people going to be ready to see, you know, gay characters on TV and see the queer experience? Like, I mean, you would think, yeah, mid 90s, you know, some people might go, no, people don't want to see that.
No. Yeah. They wouldn't even say the G word.
Yeah, you know, exactly. So, I mean, I think that people should do, you know, what they feel is important, things that they want to see. I always, I'm a fan of any show I've worked on. I don't know how to work on a show that I'm not a fan of, because I'm always rooting for the characters in the show, and I pitch what I want to see the characters do.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you do a great job of that. Yeah. So I have actually, I lied to you. I have two questions, but the I'll save the last one because it's not as heavy hitting as this one. This one is the one we talked about. What is your, what advice with the experience where you are at your level now, knowing where you want to go, right? Because, you know, we're ladies, we're always forward thinking.
Yeah, exactly.
You're never done. what advice would you give your younger writer self? Getting started, knowing where you wanted to go. Did you even imagine getting to where you are now? What's some advice you would tell yourself back then?
You know, no, I didn't imagine that I would get here. I kind of wish that I had. I think, you know, I actually, it's funny because early on in my career, I worked on Grey's Anatomy as a writer's PA, and there's an opportunity to get staffed on the show called Off the Map, and I just didn't have the materials. And the truth is, I wasn't writing, even though I was working in the industry and I had this kind of amazing opportunity to learn from TV writers, which I was doing. I really wasn't working on my own stuff. And because of that, I didn't get staffed until, like, you know, a few years later. So I wish I would have, you know, started studying the craft a little earlier. I wish I would have done my own writing and found my voice a little earlier. I think those are things I think I would have said, because I do feel that would have helped me kind of not have these kind of, I guess, detours a little bit. Yeah. But I don't know. I mean, I think the thing about writing is that because there's no clear path, to doing it, you know, all of my experiences and all of the random jobs I had and everything, I do feel like that enabled me to become, you know, kind of a well-rounded whole person before I started creating other well-rounded whole people.
Yeah, that's a good recipe to follow. my last question is not so serious, but definitely important. So obviously we've all been on shelter in place we're on week 9 now.
Oh, wow. It's week 9? Oh, boy. Okay.
So what has been your go-to quarantine cocktail?
Oh, my gosh. I love it. You know, I'm more of a wine drinker. So, you know, it's been, I guess, mostly like Pinot Noir or Sauvignon Blanc. Kind of a toss up between the two. I wish I had something
whatever mood is striking. And
if it's kind of warm, you know, like and then, you know, I might do an occasional rosé, but yeah, I'm more of a wine drinker.
Nice. And what's your go-to COVID snack?
I love Cheetos a lot, and I also love peanut M&Ms. When I was in college, I think literally the whole 4 years, I probably ate peanut M&Ms like every day.
That's your protein.
Yeah, I was like, well, it has peanuts in it.
It's my college protein.
Yeah, exactly. And then in the beginning of the quarantine, I love snacks, but in the beginning of the quarantine, I had a this huge kind of container of cheese balls that I got at like CVS or something. And I was like, oh, this will last me. Didn't. It was like, week two, I was like, oh no, I'm out of cheese balls. I didn't replace it. Instead, I just replaced it with Cheetos. I don't even think I can get the cheese balls on Instacart, which I think is a good thing. So
the universe is protecting you.
Yeah, exactly. But yes, I mean, I you know, TV writer, TV writing was perfect for me. I love snacks, love telling stories. It's like,
yeah,
match made in heaven.
Well, you're damn good at it.
thank you.
Thank you again for coming on and answering our followers' questions.
Sure. Thank you guys. Thanks all of you guys for your questions. They were so great.
Yeah, they really were. I would say, you know, one of the better sets of questions I've seen. And then tell everyone where they can catch Little Fires Everywhere.
Okay, so Little Fires Everywhere is currently streaming on Hulu. And then I believe in a couple weeks, we'll be available on Amazon Prime.
Got it. Don't miss it, guys. It's so good. I love it.
Yes.
Music, I love it. I'm a 90s kid, obviously.
Me too. Oh, I love the 90s. any like 90210 reference? Yeah. Liz and I love the 90s. So it was a lot of 90s talk.
Yeah. All right. Raamla Mohamed, thank you so much. Stay healthy. All right.
Yes, you too. Everyone stay healthy, stay safe, stay sane, whatever you can do.